Well, welcome back to Keys of the Kingdom. And we're talking about the kingdom of God, and we're talking about what you need to be doing is organizing yourselves. And you need a group of ministers that are not in the world. Not of the world. In the world, but not of the world. You are bound not by regular common law contracts, but you are bound by equitable constructive contracts. And the Pharaoh is not likely to let go easily. Kind of a pit bull on the subject, as a matter of fact. He wants you as his human resources. He calls you a human resource, and he has you as collateral for debt, and he doesn't want to pay it. He wants you to pay it, and he wants you to pay it perpetually. He doesn't want to pay off the debt. No matter how much you want to get together and organize your little political groups so that they will balance the budget, do you think that's going to happen? How's that working out for you, as the guy says? That's not the plan. The plan is to keep you in debt and to keep until you're absolutely destroyed by that debt, crushed by that debt, because there are, you just can't get into it, but that is the way of the wicked. And if you want to know what's going to happen in the future, study the past, study the history. We've done all this before, time and time again. So what was the solution? Well, the solution was the kingdom. This kingdom government, this principled government based upon faith, hope, and charity, of caring for one another, of being a witness for one another, and living in this system of voluntary, responsible people who actually show up and be what they say and do what they say they will do. And actually do this with an element of morality and caring for one another. So you have to leave the principles of Egypt behind, that it's okay to get your leeks and onions at the expense of your neighbor, your benefits at the expense of your neighbor, your daily bread at the expense of your neighbor. And that may be a process. You may be on Social Security now. You may be on welfare now. You may be getting disability now. And you're entitled to that, because that's why they call it an entitlement program. But you're entitled to it because you're a member. And like I said, Pharaoh's not going to let you go. But you can become a minister of his holy church, of Christ's holy church, of his form of government. And you can start to gather together as a free congregation in support of men who want to see you as free as they would like to be free and are willing to give up their freedom so that you might be free. Give up their personal wealth, their personal estate. One of the most common words that people do not understand in the Bible is the phrase, they owned all things in common. If God was returning every man to his possession and every man to his family, how would they own all things in common? They don't. It's the ministers who own all things in common. It was the ministers who were told to give up everything they owned, give it away to the poor, and come follow him. It didn't mean to just walk through the streets with rags, starving to death. Although it could mean that way if there are no other real Christians. It meant that they had no personal faith, that they owned all things in common. The Levites owned all things in common. I had someone talking about the Levites, and he had supposedly talked to a rabbi who was a scholar, and he didn't understand that all Levites were under what we would call today a vow of poverty. They had no personal estate. They had no inheritance. The Levites belonged to God. They had land. They had clothes. They had money in their pockets. They had no personal estate. In other words, if you kill the Levite, and you know, his whole family died out, who inherited it? Who inherited the land? Could you sell land in Israel? This may be helping you understand. Could you sell land in Israel? Well, you could sell land, but after 49 years, the land reverted back to the original owner. They owned the land. The people actually owned the land. And they couldn't sell. They could sell the use of it, but then the land would revert back to them after the year of Jubilee. And they could sell themselves into bondage. But after 7 years, they would be free again. That clause isn't in the Social Security Act. 7 years, you don't get to be free. You're stuck. You're in there. Now, you can be free again, but you got to follow the plan. It's worked before. It can work again. And you have to work at it to make it work. I always say networking works when you work at networking. And that's what you have to do. You have to come together caring about others' freedom as much as you care about your own. So the Levites were this group that were called out to be the ministers of a government based on faith, hope, and charity, free will offerings only. They could have no personal estate. They own land, and they could sell that land. But if a Levite sold you land, any other Levite could come along and redeem that land back again. They could get that land back again at any time. They didn't have to wait the 50 years or 49 years to a year of Jubilee. Well, guess what happens when you have that rule on the books? Nobody wants to buy the land. Why do you want to buy a land, put in an orchard, if you're going to have to give it back to the first Levite who walks along? You know, we actually have these things laced in our own statutes. You know, people, when you mention vow of poverty, people all get in a panic. Oh my gosh, that's the Roman Catholic Church. Oh, what are you, a Jesuit? You know, the fact is, everybody with a Social Security number in the United States is under a vow of poverty. You are under a vow of poverty already. You don't own the land. And if you read Covenant of the Gods, or just the chapter Law versus Legal, you'll see you don't own the land. The government owns the land. They can take it away anytime they want. You stop paying the use tax, you can't use it. You stop paying the use tax for a couple of years, they take it away. In the state of Oregon, they take the land away, period, before they sell it. In other states, they have a little bit different system. They will take the use of the land away and sell the use of the land to somebody else. And you can still redeem the land for about a year after they've sold it at auction. So guys who buy, I think in Texas, maybe one of those states, I can't remember, but there are several states like this, they'll sell your land at auction. If you can come up with the money that they paid at auction, you can buy back that land. So if a guy buys that land at auction, he has to know that I don't want to put any improvements in that land for at least a year, because I could come along and build a house on that land and then the guy come back and redeem it for the price that I paid for it, not including the price of my house. So you have to know these little quirks in the system, but that does not include the beneficial interest, which you would call in the Bible the milk and honey. So you're already in a common purse where you don't own the land. You're in another common purse with Social Security where you don't own your labor. They can take not only 20%, they can take 30%, 40%, 50%. Now, I'm not saying this to make you mad. I'm saying this to wake you up and to realize that those systems of Nimrod, of Pharaoh, of Caesar, fail. They will fail. They always fail. And there will be a day of reckoning. And you'll cry out to God, but he will not hear you in that day. That's what it says in the Bible over and over again. Unless you repent and turn around and start heading back to the ways of the kingdom. Stop coveting. Stop forcing your neighbor to contribute to your welfare, whether it's public school, Social Security, fire departments, what have you. Now, I know if you live in the city, that's almost impossible. You're still going to have to pay your tally of bricks. You're still going to have to pay Caesar what you owe him, even though you owe them only because of a constructive contract. But if you let go of that wealthy system, that common purse, and you say, I'm not a part of this common purse anymore, and you come out, you can do that. But I advise you only do that if you come out like Christ, like the Levites, to serve others, to be those ministers. Now, what do we call ministers? Well, that's more than a two-hour program can curtail, but the fact is those ministers are men of service who care about your welfare as much as you care about your own, and they are as much as they care about their own. It's a caring position. It's a serving position, like Christ. And they come out to do that. And they have the ability to do that and the instruments to do that and the resources to do that when you contribute to them. But you have the responsibility to only to contribute to ministers who are actually doing that, who are actually working towards that society that operates on free will offerings only and takes care of your daily bread with free will offerings only. Similar to the Good Samaritans, but with this networking kingdom concept more firmly in place, this buddy system times 10. In order to do that, you at least have to begin to form that congregation. Getting people to come together in groups of 10. Okay, what happened if you had a bunch of people in one town that got together in a group of 20? Then we have a really big church. No, you break it down again to groups of 10, because that's, you start getting 15, 20, you can't do a good job. But those two groups of 10 are still connected. It used to be considered that it wasn't really a church until you had 10 groups of 10. You had 10 ministers and 100 families linked together in a network. And on Pentecost, they had hundreds of groups of 10. Thousands formed this network of ministers of service supported by free will offerings. Because overnight they had to become the government of God. You'll get that opportunity, but you got to start somewhere. And that's what Christ's ministry was doing. That's what John the Baptist's ministry was doing. He didn't say, you know, if you stumble across somebody who has no coat, you have two, share it with them. They were forming the same types of congregations we see being formed in the days of Moses with the Levites. 10 families. Pick a minister from this pool of Levites. And if they pick a different one. It's not appointed from the top down. It's from the bottom up. You want to be in a free government? You have to start governing yourself in the ways of righteousness, caring for one another. And we're talking about the ways of the kingdom, a day in the kingdom. A day in the kingdom is, every day is church day. And when you gather together, which actually, you know, Sabbath is your day of rest. That's because you work 6 days in the kingdom. And you take a seventh day, a convocation day, off. And usually you take it off simply with your family at home. And occasionally you might have company over and you kind of all take that day off and you rest. And there's a reason for that. And there's a physical reason. There's a spiritual reason. And it's not a magical day. It's not, you can't impose it on people. You can't force them to do it. But there's a message in it. And the message not only includes what you do on that day, but what you did on the 6 days before. And the 6 days before is that you labor. I always ask people, what's the first commandment of God in the Bible? Dress it and keep it. Again, the kingdom of God is here on earth. It's at hand. It's not of the world, the constitutional order and system of governments of Nimrod, Caesars, and Pharaohs. But it's on this planet. It's a system based on free will choice, because all liberty is of God. But that liberty is within the moral confines of the precepts of God. Thou shalt not covet. Thou shalt not make covenants with them nor with their gods. Thou shalt not murder. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's goods. All these rules are basic fundamental rules, laws of nature. If you do those things, if you covet your neighbor's goods, your goods will be coveted and taken from you. If it's okay to take from your neighbor to provide your welfare, it's okay for your neighbor to take from you to provide his welfare. And you have set the rule. As you judge, so shall ye be judged. And guess what? Your neighbor has a lot more needs than you do. So he's going to take and take and take and take and take. And if you elect a leader who has the power to take, he will take. you take the first fruits of your labor, because you didn't give them up willingly. In a free will society, you wanted to force your neighbor to contribute. He will take your sons and make them run before his chariots. He will make his instruments of war. He will take your daughters and turn them into his maidservants, his confectionaries. And that's what will happen. And that's what has happened. Because you rejected God, that he should not reign over you. If God was reigning over you, you would rush to his keep, to his fold, to be together, to work together, to wander freely on the range of this planet, dressing and keeping and caring for it, caring for each other, watching out for each other, keeping an eye on each other. You would do that if Christ was in your heart. Christ is not in your heart because you belong to this religion or that religious group that isn't even religious, certainly not pure religion. Pure religion is how you take care of the widows and orphans and needy of your society. Do you do it with free will offerings? Social Security is a religious program. That is your church. And the ministers of that religion, the ministers of that religion exercise authority one over another. And you're a member of that. And you've been deceived. Now, okay, get used to it. Get over it. Now turn around. We're preaching the straight way, the narrow way, the path of God. You need to form that network. And you need to support men who are seeking to build that network. And you need to learn to give so that it may be given to you. You need to give up your life that you may have life more abundant. These are the message of the king of the only government that really wants to set you free. Really cares about you. And are willing to give up his own life that ye might be free. Shed his own blood that ye might be free. So we talked about banking on the kingdom. Now, the church is separate from the governments of the world. It's not a part of the world. It doesn't have ID numbers. If you're a minister, according to the dictates of Jesus Christ, you can't have, I mean, an ordained minister, he uses several words for ordained, you know, specifically his little flock ministers. I'm not talking about every deacon or someone, every one of us are ministers in God's kingdom. But I'm talking about the official ones where he said, I appoint unto you a kingdom. Not the whole kingdom, but the a kingdom. A right and authority to be a government. Because he was a king. That's what it said. This is the king, this is the king, this is the king. In an official Roman document. The highest son of David. And he appointed to these men. After he took the kingdom away from the Pharisees, he appointed these men to be the princes of his kingdom. But he said they could not exercise authority one over the other. When we say princes, kingdom, rulers, leaders, we think only those who can exercise authority. You can actually have a voluntary government where your leaders do not rule over you. They rule over what you give them. But they don't rule over you. They don't make you contribute and build the treasury of the kingdom. You are the treasury of the kingdom. You must contribute by your own choice only. Tax yourself only. That's a free government. And you only give to men who promote that idea. And then those men go out and seek and find, as good shepherds, those other sheep, those white-faced sheep, those range-type sheep that will come together in righteousness. Who will cling to one another in righteousness. Who will watch out for one another in righteousness. How do you let 1,000 sheep go out on the desert? Or 100 sheep go out on 1,000 acres of desert? You know, our gate is always open. They don't go out the gate. Most of the time. They used to when we had one black-faced sheep named Cora. she would lead them out the gate. Many of you have heard that story. I won't tell it again. But Cora, somebody asked yesterday, so where's Cora? Because they'd always heard the stories about Cora, which was this one black-faced sheep that we kept one year. Kept leading the sheep, you know, some of the sheep off. We sold her to the Russians, and they ate her. And actually, she had grown old, and we were going to sell her as an old, cold sheep because she was such a troublemaker. And she jumped the fence and got in with a buck and got bred one more time, so we didn't sell her. We let her have one more lamb. And then we had a guy come by and wanted to buy old ewes, just old ewes that we weren't going to keep anymore, hard bags, what have you, what we call cold sheep, sheep that aren't our best flock. And we sold him these, and he picked Cora as one of the sheep that he took. He loaded them up in a passenger van, literally in a passenger van. He had windows down the side of the van. And you could see the sheep looking out the windows in the back seat. There's more than a half a dozen sheep in the back seat. I don't remember what he took, 10 sheep in the back seat. And you look through the window and you see all these sheep looking out. Anyway, Cora went off with him. And they, in the Russian community, they eat these old mutton ewes. And so that's what happened to Cora. So she hasn't been leading them out the gate anymore. And that's what's going to happen with the cores of this world and the cores of our own network, who will not come together with the same spirit of Christ to serve others openly, laying themselves, realizing that they are naked. They're not going to be secretive. They're going to share. They're going to be honoring their word. They're going to be taking care of one another and working for to create a network that will actually do that. They will be their volunteer fire department, their volunteer insurance program, their volunteer even policemen, policemen. In other words, when somebody needs help in this community, they're constantly complaining, we don't dial 911, we dial each other. They say, you're supposed to dial 911 when you need help. No, we depend on each other. You know, the nearest police station here is 75 miles away. We don't call the police. We call each other. In the cities, you do a different thing. You need to have, you know, what is community watches? They're volunteer systems. What is the kingdom? It's a volunteer system. Occasionally, some of the local women want to go to the store and get some things in town, which is 100 miles away. And so they don't like to drive alone, so they invite somebody to go along with them. And so my wife was going to go along with her, and she said, okay, we can pick up stuff for other people. And we were telling some of the new people that are here, we can pick up. And they thought, well, no, I don't want to put anybody in any trouble. No, that's what we do here. We will go and pick up stuff for you when we go to town. And we hope that if you go to town, you will pick up stuff for us. That's casting your bread upon the water. These are the principles of the kingdom. It's here now. If you will reach out and grab it, if you will seek it and strive for it, if you will gather together in free assemblies, you will find it. And if you do that, when that holder of the equitable title of all the land in the whole world, almost all the land, he doesn't have all the land, is destroyed. And all hell is breaking loose. You will inherit the kingdom because you will still be alive. You will survive freedom. You will survive liberty under God because God will be a pillar of fire between you and disaster. But if you will not come to the aid of others, why would he come to the aid of you? You have judged it's okay to be selfish. So it's okay for God to be selfish. Okay for you not to listen to the cries and needs of your neighbor. So it's okay that God not listen to the needs and cries of you. So in these books that we put out, and I have several people here helping me over the next couple of months, although I got twice the workload probably because we're getting ready for our fall retreat at the last week of September. And if you want those campfire talks, that's where you're going to hear them. Don't come after the retreat and say you want my undivided attention. come during the retreat to get to know the free assembly of others and try to make it as big a deal. You know, at the fall retreat, Feast of Tabernacle, and I'm amazed at the number of people who haven't quite grasped this yet, you invited the stranger in your midst. This is not a convocation exclusive to those seeking the kingdom. This is a festival for all the people in the network, in the extended network, and even the strangers in our midst who don't understand the network. This is an outreach festival. That's what it says. If you go and read the book, they're telling you something. Pay attention. Do your homework. So now, can we show them the fruit of the kingdom? Can we be that kingdom for a week and come and share with each other enough so that people will see, hey, this makes sense. No wonder I'm a slave. I made a slave of my neighbor. No wonder I am bound in a social welfare system that should have been for my welfare but has become a snare because I was willing to work privately for my neighbor's blood. And I am trapped in the very net of my own creation. Now, those of you who have read Proverbs 1:10 and Paul and our writings know what I'm talking about. I'm quoting right out of the text of the Bible, the quotes you'll never hear in your modern churches, because your modern churches have strayed from the ways of Christ. They've brought in their damnable heresies that it's okay to covet your neighbor's goods. So all you need to do is gather together in those congregations and start having your own campfire talks. Because I share lots of information with those ministers I see actually doing the work. Some minister says, I'm doing the work. I don't need to tell you about it. Well, you don't. But if you don't tell me about it, it didn't happen. I only bear witness to what I see if you don't show me. If your congregation is a secret congregation, it will remain secret to me. And I will not bear witness that it exists. It's all about bearing witness, two or more witnesses. I'm not the witness for everybody. But anyway, the church has bank accounts without numbers, without any numbers whatsoever. And some churches are trying, I said churches, and actually I should, because the temples in Egypt were the banks, and of course banks are temples. And they want to exclude us. And, of course, they have a right to exclude us. But they cannot exclude the people they bind into their system from worshiping at the altars of His Holy Church, of Christ's Holy Church. That is a violation of their own rules. So if you want to help us keep that door open, join the network, because we're going to share some information in the next day. So you got to join that network right away about how to keep that door open. And they're going to keep trying to close it, but that's okay, because when they force that closure, they finally have to open another door, which lets you become free. Because if they exclude you from the free choice of religion and their hypothecating constructive altars, then they violate their own laws. So if you want to be free, we have to back them into the corner so that they're over here and we're over there. We have to gather at the Red Sea. We'll still have the sea at our back, but God will part that. So metaphors. Separate from them. We have to become our own insurance company based on mutual assurance, free will. We have to become our own, again, fire department. Community watch, all these things. And you can only do that if you network as a kingdom. It's not a congregation, it's a kingdom. But the kingdom is composed of free congregations, free assemblies, who actually are doing what Christ said to do. So I don't know, I'm repeating myself, but the fact is you have to make that choice and really start working and contributing to the welfare of your neighbor. You have to start that flow of life from you out to the others seeking the kingdom so that God can fill you up with more life so that you may have life more abundant. If you just want to keep it all and have it all and be free and have your own land and have your little comfortable congregation, that's not kingdom thinking. And we have a tremendous amount of information laid out on how to do this. Freeing that living land next to you, next door to you, down the street from you. That's what you need to do. I'm sitting here looking out the window, watching birds come into our cherry tree and steal cherries. And there will be people that come to our network that try to steal cherries too. But anyway, that's you work with nature in the kingdom, and nature will work with you. And if you work with each other in the kingdom, each other will work with you. And you need to start building those bonds based on faith, hope, and charity to survive the days to come. And that's what they were doing during the plagues of Egypt. And we see those plagues around the corner. We've seen the economic plagues already coming since 2008, and actually even before, but there's certainly been a decided turn towards the decaying economy and collapsing economy. But we see it also in agriculture. We even see it in geology and weather conditions. I mean, a great deal of the crop loss this year has been due to weather during the solar max. And there will be more. And we are not always going to be able to go down to the store and buy another bag of groceries. As a matter of fact, those who seek the kingdom, seek to be separate, to follow the ways of Christ, will even be excluded. You will not get your straw from the barrel. They won't give it to you. They won't let you in their store. They won't let you have their gas. That will come, rationing. So you need to form that kingdom. But you don't want to form it out of fear. You have to form it out of love, because fear will not keep you together.